This video was sponsored by Kenhub. More on them at the end of the video.
Hello and welcome. My name is Patrick, and in this video, I'll teach you some of my tips and tricks for remembering all of the skeletal muscles of the pelvis that you would see in an anatomy class. And to make this lesson more manageable for beginners, I'll present the list in smaller chunks of 4 to 8 muscles. You can find a list of the sections and timestamps in the description below. With that out of the way, let's get into the muscles. So this is going to be the shortest video in the muscle series, and while there are only a few muscles to learn, I made this one its own unit because I imagine the pelvic muscles slightly differently than the muscles of the arms and legs, for instance. Like, instead of a clear elbow flexion or spinal extension muscle, you have muscles that support the pelvic floor, or that promote blood flow during sexual arousal. And that's really cool to me! The pelvis has skeletal muscles that interact with the urinary, digestive, and reproductive systems, which makes these muscles seem like magical and mysterious, but at the end of the day, they're still muscles. And like most of the muscles we've seen before, the name of the muscle usually tells us what the muscle does or where it is. But since the pelvis is a big bone, anatomists refer to certain parts of the pelvis by their bony landmarks. So let's review. While the whole thing is called the pelvis, we refer to these big wings as the ilium or ilia. If you're putting your hands on your hips, you're not actually putting them on your hip joint, you're putting them on your ilia. In the front, you have two pubic bones, which are joined by a piece of soft tissue called the pubic symphysis. Posteriorly, you have these hollowed out bumps called the ischium. Colloquially, I've heard these called the sits bones as well. Then this big centerpiece is the sacrum, the base of your spinal column. And hanging off the tip is one of the remnants of our evolution, the ancestral tailbone called the coccyx. Once you know those bony landmarks, you can start putting terms together. So this joint is the sacroiliac joint, since it's the meeting place between the sacrum and the ilium. And that same strategy works for many of these muscles. This first chunk of muscles is collectively called the levator ani group, which counterintuitively doesn't lift the anus necessarily, it keeps your organs from falling out of your pelvis. Yes, you have some connective tissue there, but these muscles are the floor of the pelvis, hence pelvic floor muscles. The centerpiece is the pubococcygeus, which connects the pubic bones in front with the coccyx in the back. It forms like a hammock-esque muscle with some important cutouts for an anus and genitals here and here. This little divot posteriorly isn't a cutout. It's arched so that it can connect with more surface area on the bone. Hanging out within that muscle is the puborectalis, which originates on the pubic bones and forms this structure called the puborectal sling around the rectum. If you've heard about the squatty potty and how squatting makes it easier to poop, the puborectalis is the muscle that supposedly puts a kink in the colon. That's a whole other video though. The last muscle in the levator ani group needs a bit of introduction. Now, I've spent the last hour of video telling you about how intuitive these names are, how if you just know the bony anatomy or directional terms, then you're set. But here, with less than 10 muscles to go, the iliococcygeus is the crack in the sidewalk that's tripping us up over the finish line. It starts off intuitive, it's easy to see where it inserts on the coccyx, but its origin is this broad sheet of connective tissue called the internal obturator fascia, not the ilium. It's fine, anatomy, I'm not mad, I'm just disappointed. If we move on, we'll see another important pelvic floor muscle, the ischiococcygeus, a long sheet of muscle that spans from each ischium to the coccyx in the center. Although, fair warning, some textbooks just call this muscle the coccygeus, which I'm rapidly losing faith in traditional naming conventions for this group of muscles, just do your best. Something else to keep in mind, you'll almost always get quizzed on these muscles from a superior or top-down view, and from this angle, you'll see some of the other hip muscles, like the piriformis posteriorly, and the obturator internus anteriorly. So if possible, identify what those muscles attach to, because if they attach to the femur, then they're not pelvic floor muscles, and they won't have pubo or coccygeus in their names. But this next group, the perineal muscles, requires the opposite perspective, an inferior view. Also, how do I put this? If you're watching this in public at a coffee shop or something, just be aware of who's looking over your shoulder because the images I'm about to show you are going to get a little spicy. From this inferior view, we can see some of the structure of the perineum, the area between the genitals and anus, and a few of the muscles in this area use the perineal region in their names. For instance, take a look at the superficial transverse perinei. You already know superficial, it's closer to the surface, and you already know transverse, it runs side to side instead of front to back. The perinei points to its location, between the urethra anteriorly and anus posteriorly.
Deep to that is the deep transverse perinei with the same naming conventions. Also in the perineal area, you can find muscles that plug into the genitals but have different presentations depending on what kind of plumbing we're working with. The first, the ischiocavernosus, originates at the ischium and connects with the genitals. If it's attached to a penis, it inserts on the crus or crura of the penis, the part that attaches to the ischial rami, while the rest of the shaft, mostly the corpus cavernosum, dangles off. For people with vaginas, the ischiocavernosus actually inserts on the clitoris. And remember, the clitoris is much bigger than the small piece that you see on external diagrams. As far as how to remember this muscle, the ischio root is easy enough to remember, but the cavernosus relates more to its function. I'll explain. During sexual arousal, blood flows into the penis or clitoris, enlarging either. When the ischiocavernosus contracts, it squishes blood towards the distal part of the genitals and compresses some of the veins that drain blood from the genitals, which helps maintain an erection or the swelling of the clitoris. And that's a fun fact that you can bring up if you're ever, like, in that situation, but we still need to remember it for our exam. I remember ischiocavernosus because it connects the ischium to caverns of blood, hence ischiocavernosus. Another muscle in that same area is the bulbospongiosus, which, no, is not a Pokemon. When it accompanies a vagina, the pair of muscles runs from the pubic bone in front along the sides of the vagina. Around penises, it circles the bulb of the penis, which is close to the base. I remember this one because it plugs into the spongy tissue that gets erect during sex. Bordering the perineum, you have two different tubes regardless of the sex of your model, an anus and a urethra. Obviously, we don't want anything leaking out of those tubes involuntarily, so we have some muscles that squeeze those tubes shut. These ring-like muscles are called sphincters, and we have a few. The internal sphincters are actually smooth muscle under involuntary control, but the external sphincters, one around the anus and one around the urethra, are skeletal muscles and are controlled voluntarily. So when you're trying to hold in your poop, you're actively contracting the external anal sphincter. Most of the time, your smooth muscle internal sphincter does the trick on its own, though. So why do we have two? Well, smooth muscle is much richer in mitochondria, so it can contract for long bouts of time without fatiguing. We only use the external sphincter when we're really trying to hold back the floodgates. That's gross. What makes this muscle weird, though, is how it doesn't anchor into any bone. It kind of blends in with the other pelvic and perineal muscles, but as far as the scope of this video, just look for the bullseye. It's easy to find. On the other hand, the external urethral sphincter will surround the urethra. For people with penises, the external urethral sphincter is right below the prostate at the base of the penis. For people with vaginas, they have shorter urethras, so there will be an internal urethral sphincter right below the bladder, and then right below that is going to be the external. But no matter what kind of genitals you have, the internal sphincter is right below the bladder, almost like you're pinching a water balloon shut. So now we've built a solid foundation for the pelvic organs to sit in, but there are still some genital-specific muscles to consider. If you have testicles, you have a cremaster muscle, a thin layer of muscle that lines the scrotum and tucks the testicles into the body. If it's too cold, this thing contracts and brings them towards body heat. I remember this one because its main job is to turn up the heat on the testicles. It's kind of like the cremaster is trying to cremate the testes. That's my memory device, but I'm sure someone's already typing their little jokey jokes into the comments section. Now, these are just the tricks that I personally use to remember these muscles, but if you want another great resource for learning anatomy, then you need to check out Kenhub. I use them all the time when researching and writing these videos, and for this series in particular, their written articles and atlas of muscles have been extremely helpful in refreshing my knowledge of some of those deeper, smaller muscles. They've also got an enormous library of in-depth videos about muscles, histology, vasculature, nerves, and everything else you'd need to know in anatomy class. All those beautiful illustrations that you saw in this video came from them. And in addition to their library of content, I also love Kenhub's quiz feature. They allow you to build custom quizzes with different difficulties, and they give you feedback so you can figure out where your weaknesses are. You can use most of Kenhub's features for free, but if you want full access to all of their learning content and quizzes, then go to khub.me/corporis to get 10% off your subscription. They've also got a no questions asked 7-day money back guarantee, so you can try out the premium version for 7 days, and if you don't like it, get your money back. If you want to see the next video in the muscle memorization series, then check out this playlist here. Otherwise, subscribe, leave a like on the video, have fun, be good. Thanks for watching.